Good afternoon to all of you. I'm Dr. Padma Gunaratna, President, Sri Lanka Medical Association. I warmly welcome all of you for this seminar in rehabilitation of amputees, organized by the Expert Committee in Medical Rehabilitation of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. As we know, previously, we had many amputees for us to manage as war victims, but now with the escalating incidence of non-communicable diseases and with along with diabetes mellitus, it's likely that we will end up with more and more cases of diabetes and amputation following as a complication of diabetes. So therefore, it becomes very important for all doctors who are with interest in medical rehabilitation, be competent in rehabilitating amputees. So on behalf of the Expert Committee in Medical Rehabilitation, I'm very thankful to Dr. Dhumindra Munidasa for accepting our invitation and also for his team for agreeing to do this seminar in rehabilitation of amputees. So we have lined up four eminent speakers. Our first speaker would be Dr. Naomi Senaratne. She would be giving us an account on introduction to amputee rehabilitation. Dr. Naomi Senaratne is the acting consultant in rehabilitation medicine, RRH. So let me invite Dr. Naomi Senaratne to make her presentation. Thank you.
Good morning to everyone. I'm Dr. Naomi Senaratne. I would like to welcome you for the seminar on amputee rehabilitation. So the first presentation would be on introduction of amputee rehabilitation. And then there will be a couple of presentations by team members of our amputee rehabilitation program in Rehabilitation Hospital, Ragama. The word amputation derived from the Latin word amputare, which means to cut away. Amputation is complete removal of injured or deformed part of limb, which results in many physical, social, and emotional consequences. What is the main goal of rehabilitation of amputees? It is actually aimed at preventing any complications of immobility and consecutively successful community reintegration. Keeping that in mind, I'd like to take you to the basic concepts of amputee rehabilitation first, and then we'd like to show you how the concepts of amputee rehabilitation are applied to a patient with lower limb amputation. Similarly, in other rehab programs, rehabilitation of amputees is also a team approach. Many people who are skilled and trained in different fields actively involved in the management. Team consists of surgeon, rehab specialist who bears the main responsibility of rehabilitation of amputee and his or her team members, which includes nurse who trained in stump care, physiotherapist who aims at muscle strengthening, functional mobility and the pre-prosthetic training, occupational therapist who address activities of daily living training, home and community reintegration, prosthetist who designs and fabricates the device according to the needs of the patient, social worker who incorporates government or non-governmental financial supports with rehab management, and the psychologist, most importantly, who maintains emotional stability of the patient. There are five phases of amputee rehabilitation. First phase is pre-amputation phase, which involves the period before the amputation until once it has become a treatment option. Second phase would be the amputation phase. Thirdly, post-amputation phase, which involves stump care following amputation and other rehab interventions, followed by primary amputee rehabilitation phase. Once the patient enters into inpatient rehab program, aiming at delivery of proper processes. Finally, follow-up phase, amputee review and maintenance. Pre-amputation phase. I'd like to highlight the importance of multidisciplinary rehab involvement in the pre-amputation phase first. So this phase starts when amputation becomes a clinical option in the patient's management. Amputation should be shared decision with the discussion about residual limb length and amputation level to gain better outcomes of rehabilitation. Patient education is extremely important, especially about phantom limb pain, medical and physical assessment, which includes power of crutch muscles, joint mobility, balance reactions in sitting and standing, because those are crucial in terms of future functional regaining. And most importantly, this should be followed by proper exercise program to maintain and improve muscle strength, plus or minus cardiopulmonary conditioning program to maintain the cardiac and pulmonary fitness. Amputation phase. The important thing in this phase is you have to create a proper stump. For example, there should be appropriate length of residual bone for proper prosthetic fitting and functional training. It is recommended that in transfemoral amputation, the optimal length of the residual bone is approximately 23 to 27 centimeters from greater trochanter, as you can appreciate in this picture. And in transtibial amputation, optimal length should be 12 to 17 centimeters. Post-amputation rehabilitation. It should encompass many interventions. Most valuably, pain control, especially phantom limb pain management, is crucial because it is the foundation of good emotional balance, which desired early and rapid recovery for rehabilitation interventions thereafter. So the next important thing is promotion of wound healing. At this phase, a rehab team should reanalyze the patient and assess whether the patient is a suitable candidate to enter into the primary amputee rehabilitation. There can be many drawbacks. Sometimes patient might dislike for the processes and secondary complications. So then the other important interventions like optimal range of motions, muscle strengthening and mobility training exercises, which are mainly responsibilities of physiotherapist and occupational therapist. As I mentioned earlier, good post-operative analgesia is a main priority. There are two varieties of phantom limb phenomenon. One is phantom limb sensation, which is the sensation that the limb is still present, which is not really cumbersome. Phantom pain. It is various painful sensations in the body part that is no longer present, which is very distracting and difficult to bear. Studies have proven that persons with phantom limb pain have worse or lower health related quality of life. So, to reduce stump edema and promote wound healing, rigid or semi-rigid dressing can be applied. These are removable plaster of Paris or vacuum dressing and applied consecutively depending on the status and the level of the edema. There are several complications of stump post-operatively which are really needed to closely monitor and address. They are hematoma, wound dehiscence, infection, tissue necrosis, bone erosions or osteomyelitis, and skin related problems, pigmentation, rashes, so on. Primary amputee rehabilitation. It is a journey of regaining desired functional improvement with the prosthesis. The phase commences with the decision of rehabilitation with the prosthesis, and it extends until the patient is stable for fitting for artificial limb with proper confidence and competence with the device to use it. Initial part of primary amputee rehabilitation is pre-prosthetic training, which involves proper shaping and care of stump. Ideally, stump should be cylindrical in shape with adequate bone length. Additionally, the other interventions like muscle strengthening, range of motion exercises and functional mobility exercises are also important. This will be discussed in next lectures by our physiotherapist. realistic rehabilitation goals for prosthetic use and setting those realistic rehabilitation goals is very important, and it always should be tallying with the patient's expectation. Research have proved one that inpatient rehabilitation programs for amputees are likely to prove more satisfactory than prolonged outpatient rehabilitation with regard to patient survival. The next phase would be the prosthetic fitting and gait analysis. Following fabrication of the device, prosthetic fitting will be done by prosthetist, and gait analysis to identify any gait deviation will be followed, aiming at necessary modification. In other countries, the gait analysis is done in gait labs, incorporating computer-generated 3D kinematics and kinetic data. But however, we analyze with our clinical and video-based data. As a final phase, amputee review and maintenance, we should revisit for the rehab goals and the patient's need and provide necessary adjustments. Valid, reliable functional outcome measures like amputee mobility predictor, 10 meter walk test or 6 minute walking test are important to assess and monitor the functional improvement and their maintenance. Other problems we need to address in this reviews are skin and soft tissue problems, falling and fear of falling, residual limb issues. There can be ulcers and other problems in the other part of the limb or the sound side, comorbid cardiovascular diseases and mechanical maintenance issues. There can be mechanical problems with regards to the prosthetic device. So I hope that will be helpful you to have the idea of basic concepts of amputee rehabilitation, and now let's apply these concepts to a patient who was referred to us with the lower limb amputation. This is about a 59 years old lady with history of a left-sided transfemoral amputation due to malignant schwannoma, and she referred to a with the expectation of walking by using prosthesis. She was a teacher without any comorbidities and pre-mobility functioning well. She experienced phantom limb pain. There was excruciating pains, really distracting to her. So she was managed by pain management specialist with medications and a couple of sympathetic nerve blocks. She has good family support. She lives in a three-story house, and even though she is not depressed, she was emotionally upset. During physical assessment, the stump was healthy without any skin or other complications, but stump shape is quite wedgy, bulbous in shape. It is should be cylindrical shape in ideally, but there are no joint contractures as you can see here. Hip flexion, abduction, extension, and all the movements of the hip joint is normal in ranges without contractures. Muscle power was 4+ in the amputation side, and other three limbs had normal power. She has good sitting balance. As you can see here, she is having good standing balance with bilateral crutches. I think most of you are familiar with the ICF biopsychosocial model, which we use to analyze disabled people in terms of rehabilitation. When we analyze her details, we found many functional impairments and limitations in all three levels. Here I coded them according to ICF functional codes. At body level, you see this patient has partial absence of lower limb and decreased muscle strength, emotional functions changes. As she is living in a three-story house, there are limitations of activities like go up and down, mobility at outside, and she was a teacher, so obtaining and keeping the job is really a problematic, and because she's emotionally upset and because of the mobility, she's socially isolated. And the other contextual factors like environment factors, accessibility at home, products to support mobility. She already have crutches, pair of crutches and a walk. And the personal factors, age, fairly mid-age, so have a good functional outcomes, and pre-morbidly, she's completely a healthy person. So no cardiovascular or any other chronic medical problems, which is actually a positive factor. And she actually came to us with the expectation of walking. So keeping this mind, I like to conclude my presentation at this stage. And our team members will explain to you that what is the role of them in terms of rehabilitation of this amputee, and how we actually approach these issues of this particular patient in our rehab program. I would like to answer for your questions at the end of session. So thanks again. And I would like to invite for the next lecture for our physiotherapist. She will be discussing about the physiotherapist's role and how they actually attend to this particular case scenario.
Thank you, Dr. Naomi. Thank you very much for that detailed account. For an introduction to amputee rehabilitation, let me now invite Mrs. Nuwani Gamage and Mr. Damith Veerakkodi to make their presentation. They are physiotherapists at RRH to make their presentation on prosthetic interventions and follow-up of amputees. Mrs. Nuwani Gamage and Mr. Damith Veerakkodi. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm physiotherapist Nuwani Gamage from Rehabilitation Hospital, Ragama. Today, I'm delivering your presentation regarding pre-prosthetic physiotherapy interventions and follow-ups. In this presentation, it includes definition, complications of amputation, pre-prosthetic management, and post-prosthetic management. In definition, amputation is a surgical removal of a limb or a part of a limb through a bone or a multiple bones. Disarticulation is a surgical removal of a limb or a part of a limb through a joint. Definition itself shows how this procedure is massive and complicated. So let's see what are the post-surgical complications that can be frequently seen. Those are hemorrhage and hematoma, infection and tissue necrosis, neuromas, hyperesthesia, ulceration, pain and edema of the stump, wound breakdown, dermatological complications, muscle atrophy, phantom sensation, phantom limb pain, contractures and deformities. The terms which are highlighted in these sections are the areas which physiotherapists address in their pre-prosthetic management. So let's see what is the role of the physiotherapist in amputee management. Actually, they play the main role in the process of guiding the amputated person into his fully normal lifestyle. How they do that? In the physiotherapy management, they have divided into two as pre-prosthetic management and post-prosthetic management. Actually, the pre-prosthetic management starts as soon as the end of the period of adequate bed rest and immobility, and it lasts up to the final prosthetic fitting. The post-prosthetic management starts just after the end of the prosthetic delivery and lasts until the entire rehabilitation, entire rehabilitation process. In pre-prosthetic management, why pre-prosthetic management is important? Because to prepare the patient for proper prosthetic casting and fitting, day training, lifetime prosthetic use. How? Via proper and accurate assessment an individualized or client-centered program. Why it is so important? Because primary skills of prosthetic training helps to build the foundation which is necessary for successful lifelong prosthetic ambulation. Primary skills of pre-prosthetic training helps to build the foundation which is necessary for successful lifelong prosthetic ambulation. In the pre-prosthetic management, a physiotherapist involves several areas. These are the areas what physiotherapist involves: patient's expectations, motivation and psychology, skin integrity, scar management, desensitization, stump shaping and shrinking, joint range of motion, muscle strength, contractures and deformity prevention, core stability and global body conditioning, and cardiovascular fitness. Let's see how they involve each and every section. In motivation, expectations and psychology, after discussion with the patient, they have to understand what are the expectations of the patient. At the same time, they have to briefly describe about the current situation of the patient. If they feel any drop of motivation there, so they have to motivate the patient to achieve his or her final goal. And always keep in mind to remind their capacities, responsibilities, as well as the role in the family. And the important thing is always have to encourage them for community access and describe the importance of final outcome and what are the external supports they have. And the other important thing is always need to discourage the loneliness. Through all of this, we have to gradually set their mind for final goal and final outcome. Then move to skin integrity. Skin integrity. Actually, the skin of the stump is the current weight-bearing surface. After an amputation, stump of the skin of the stump is the current weight-bearing surface. So, it is to maintain it properly is very important. What are the problems that can commonly seen in skin in the stumps? Those are poor vascularity and infections, adhesive scars and dry skin with cracks, bony prominences and bony landmarks, skin rashes and unhealed wounds. Are there any solutions? Yes. One is medical management and nursing care. The second one is therapeutic management. There, in the therapeutic management, we expose the patient to graded and monitor pressure and friction force through therapeutic manipulation procedures such as stroking and stump bandaging. The other important thing is personal hygiene. It is must. Always we need to advise the patient to daily wash the stump and wipe it gently and maintain dry and moist. Then we move to scar management. As I mentioned in a previous section, skin in the scar is the current weight-bearing surface. After an amputation throughout his, their life, the weight-bearing surface is skin. So, maintain it with complication-free weight-bearing surface is very important. So, if we not maintain that, what can be happen? There will be movement restrictions and chance of skin breakdown, uneven weight distribution, and unwanted shearing forces on surrounding tissues. So, the solution is proper scar mobilization. In scar mobilization, there are several considerations. Actually, there is no any specific or strict time frame to start and end the scar mobilization, but we have to commence it on and continue it on stable scar. And safety precautions must take for infection control and need to keep in mind to apply gentle pressure. We use several therapeutic manipulative procedures for this scar mobilization. Then, desensitization. Why this desensitization is needed? Because they have phantom pain and phantom limb sensation. It is disturbed, it will disturb the entire rehabilitation process. So, we have to, at the beginning, we have to cut it off. So therefore, we use desensitization using therapeutic manipulative techniques such as stroking, tapping, and transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, as well as mirror therapy. Then this is the part, one of the most important part in the tripostatic management, that is stump shaping and shrinking. The aim of this stump shaping and shrinking is to build a stump that is which is very suitable for casting and weight bearing without any complications. We have to apply this on stable stump till the prosthetic casting. The way we use is proper compression therapy. Let's see what is the ideal presentation of stump, that is actually cylindrical shape. There won't be any excess tissues, won't be no any excess tissues, and the edges must be neat and tapered, but the adequate of tissue coverage must be there, and ultimately the shape of the stump must be cylindrical. Though this is the ideal presentation, but in clinical practice we can't see this frequently. There are any other common presentations such as bulbous shape, square-ended shape, conical shape, and excess distal tissues. These can be due to some surgical techniques as well as improper management. If we do the shaping of the stump, then the no compression therapy before casting and fitting, or improper compression therapy before casting and fitting, there must be rapid post-fitting volume reduction. So it causes to multiple recast. Ultimately, it end up with time wasting, resource wasting, increased risk of skin breakdown, and increase the workload. But we properly apply compression therapy before fitting and casting and fitting, there is a maximum reduction of precasting volume. So number of recast will minimal, and time reduce, resource, workload, risk of skin breakdown, and cost of rehabilitation all are reduced. So, stump shrinking. For shrinking the stump, we use several techniques as compression therapy, elevation, active exercises, and patient education. In our hospital, we normally use for compression therapy, bandaging is the one we use frequently. Let's see how. There must be several considerations. That is, always we have to maintain the figure of eight at the stump region, and the stump bandaging must be free of squeezes. And the other thing is the pressure must be adequate, not more pressure.
I'm Monica Mahe. Today I'm going to talk stump bandaging technique for a trans-tibial tendinitis patient. Before we move to stump bandaging, we must know several facts. First, why we need bandage. Normally, the stumps are bulky with a lot of soft tissues and irregular in shape. So we have to correct the shape and as well as the size. For that, the size of shape of the stump must be a conical one or tapered one. So, for those effects, we use bandaging. The second one is the type of bandage we choose. Always, the type of bandage must be a cotton crepe one with less elasticity, like this. And it must be a strong and not fray easily, and also not a thick one. Then, as the bandaging is a compression therapy, there are several risks with wrong bandaging. When we exert wrong force to the stump, then we disturb our vascular system. So then in turn cause for the wound healing and blisters or ulcers, as well as it will mismatch the shape of the stump you
was need for the prosthetic fittings. So, by keep those in mind, let's move to the bandaging. You have to hold bandage like this. Hold the bandage like this and keep the bandage underneath your thigh, just above the knee joint, and pull the bandage downwards until you reach the stump end. Then there, you can bring the bandage upward till you reach the same and opposite point where you start your bandage. There you have to wrap two rounds around this, around the thigh. We wrap it to fix the bandage to the leg. Then there you cross the knee like this and bring the bandage to the distal leg. There you give a pull to downward and inward and bring it to the anterior side, and again you have to wrap once here. Then you bring the bandage to the same and opposite point, and you here you start the figure of eight. By experience, you can understand what amount of force you need to do the correct bandaging for a particular patient. Here you have to be aware not to wrap your bandage one over another, then it will create extra force to that particular point. Then likewise continue the figure of eight. And always keep in your mind not to make creases when you doing bandaging. It will also exert excessive pressure, as well as it will mismatch the shape of the stump. For this patient, we can use only one bandage, but there are some patients one bandage is not enough. Normally, we fix the last point, end point of the bandage most lateral to the of the stump, from avoid the other limb by damages from this. If you need two bandages, remove this. And take another bandage and continue the bandage to the last point where you end your first bandage. There are no many different methods. This is also same as the first bandage. Like this. And hand hygiene is very much important when you're doing bandaging. And also you have to tell your patient to wash the bandage regularly. and also you must tell him if he or she feel any pain, remove their bandage. This is just a basic method for a transtibial amputation. If you met with a complex stump, go for a qualified physiotherapist for proper bandaging. Thank you.
Then let's move to the other part, which is elevation, which we use for stump shrinking. Elevation we achieve by positioning the stump on a pillow or use stump board. Then the other important part of this pre-prosthetic management is joint range of motion. If we not maintain joint range of motion properly, there will be contractures. It causes a complicated casting and fitting, which in turn cause to complicated gait training with long-term gait deviations. This will end up with insufficient gait pattern, which ultimately end up with not achieving the full potential of the client. If we maintain it properly, there will be no any contraction, so uncomplicated casting and fitting, complication gait, pre-gait training period, and energy efficient gait pattern, so we can achieve the full potential of the client. Actually, these contractures and deformities are easy to obtain but very hard to correct. But it disturbs energy expenditure, lifelong limb use, and level of independence. But the most important thing is it is avoidable. Why these contractures and deformities arise? The main cause is incorrect resting position. As you can see in the first three pictures, the patient placed their limb on flexed knee position, so they end up with the knee flexor contractures. The fourth one, the bony knee amputation, he placed his limb on hip abducted and hip flex position, so he end up with hip abductor and hip flexor contracture. Other cause is muscular imbalance. These can be due to surgical technique, anatomical muscle imbalance, or soft tissue shortening. When we talk about the muscle strength in pre-prosthetic management, after an amputation, there can be muscle weakness in either sound side or in amputated side, and also muscle atrophy. This can be due to immobility, prolonged non-use, anatomical imbalance, as well as due to contraction. To gain and maintain strength and range of motion, as well as to prevent contractures, we use several interventions such as education, the patient caregiver and nurses, exercise and stretches, positioning, if something happened, take immediate interventions and manage the problem properly. In exercises, the exercises must start as soon as possible after pain get managed. There the patient education is important, and we have to prevent the abnormal movements. In patient education, we have to give proper demonstration for them, and the other important thing is reassessment to see whether they are doing their exercises as we demonstrate them. Otherwise, if they not do that, they will cause or improper gait pattern. In above knee or below knee exercises, we can't only target on amputated side and sound side. We have to exercise for whole body. Take it as a whole, because in early rehabilitation, early ambulation process, we need our upper limb strength for training. So we have to strengthen our upper limb as well as strengthening lower limbs. In core stability and global body conditioning, we use backward and forward posture reactions, balance activities, upper extremity exercises, sit to stand practice, exercise in standing, core control and stability exercises, and coordination exercises. These are several exercises that we are normally use in our pre-posturic management. First one shows the core stability, the second one upper limb strengthening, third one upper limb and lower limb as well as core stability, fourth one also core stability, fifth one upper limb, lower limb and core, the sixth one coordination and core stability. The final thing is cardiovascular fitness. This is an essential component in pre-posturic rehabilitation process because we need gain their endurance in early rehabilitation process, because in the ambulation with prosthetic device is a energy wasting process. So the aim of this cardiovascular fitness is to fulfill the high energy consumption via aerobic exercise. Then let's move quickly to the post-prosthetic management. Aim of this post-prosthetic management is to achieve successful full potential rehabilitation process for lifelong prosthetic gait. Through proper and accurate gait training with pre-op gait deviations. In pre-prosthetic post-prosthetic management, the gait training is the initial part. So we have to train the prepare the patient for weight training. Therefore, we train them weight bearing and balance exercises, specific and basic gait training exercises, advanced gait training, and finally functional exercises. But the one thing is very important, to discourage from walking by themselves just after they receive the prosthetic device. Actually, this amputee gait training is quite a complicated process. And it is also client-centered. And the other thing is we have to achieve it gradually. So in this client-centered program, in achieving gradually, we have to consider several facts such as posture correction, stump care, encourage the patient, limb use, don't endorphin, achieve full potential, education, balance training, rapport buildup. So it is quite a complicated process. So we have think about the client situation and have to tailor the gait training program. We can't apply the same technique for each and every patient. In weight bearing exercises, first we start them inside the parallel bars. But here, in the early stage, we have to be with the patient to make the confidence and to gain reliability about the patient's performance. Balance exercises also start inside the parallel bars, then we slowly move to outside advanced balance exercises. In basic gait training, we start inside the parallel bars by holding, by using both upper limbs, then gradually we reduce the use of the upper limbs, and then we satisfied the gait, then we can move to outside even ground. The choice of the aids depend with the patient. It can be a pair of elbow crutches, a walker, or a cot cane, or without any aid. Actually, we target for young patients to make them fully independent without using any. Advanced gait training means train them for managing up and down slopes. These are the few exercises that we use in our post-prosthetic gait training. Last is functional exercises. Our aim in this process is to make the patient fully independent in the society. So we have to train them functional activities. We have to achieve their full capacities. For that purpose, we use functional exercises. These are several functional exercises normally we apply on our patients. In this presentation, actually in this amputee management process, there are several important steps. One is patient education, proper guidance, communication, follow-ups, verbal explanation, visual feedback, exercise demonstration, and movement generation. This is all about my presentation, and thank you very much to hearing me giving attention to my presentation. And I would like to give special thanks to consultant rheumatologist Duminda Munidasa for providing me this valuable opportunity. And I would like to hand over to continue this presentation to Mr. Damit Veerakodi.
Thank you very much, Ms. Nomani. I'm Damit Veerakodi, physiotherapist at Prosthetist and Orthotist Clinic Rehabilitation Hospital, Ragama. So from my presentation, I would like to talk about a case scenario where we are managing a amputee patient, a bony amputation case study. The basic complaint of the patient on admission was she was unable to walk independently and difficulties in engaging her ADS, activities of daily living, following the above knee amputation in her left side lower limb. So this is the demographic data. I'm not going to elaborate on it. And when talking about her occupational history, she was an advisor in Department of Education. And this incident happened when she was on duty during the incident. Her past medical history, there were no specific illnesses. When considering about the past surgical history, which is not related to this case scenario, she has done a hemorrhoidectomy in 2012. When come to the clinical presentation of her complaints, in 2017, she had a low back pain with left side lower limb pain. Then in 2017, she was diagnosed a malignant Noachian tumor, which is called neurofibrosarcoma under the popliteal region of the left side. In 2018, that tumor was operated. In 2019, again the clinical symptoms were there. That means the recurrent tumor was there. And in 2021, on February 1st, she has done a bony amputation at National Hospital, Sri Lanka. So when she came to us, the problems on admissions were her stump was, there was a swelling in her stump. Then she had presence of phantom sensation, inappropriate shape of the stump for an prosthesis, impaired dynamic sitting balance, impaired single leg standing, and she was unable to walk independently. And also a sense of slight tightness in her hip abductors and hip flexors. Then our short-term goals were to reduce the swelling of the stump by bandaging, soft tissue mobilization and active exercises, and sharpening the stump by bandaging. How to use the bony amputation bandaging. Actually, when we apply for a real patient in the real case scenario, we have to do it by wearing the underwear. But here, due to ethical issues, we have to do the bandaging over her dress. Here, the size of bandage we are using is cotton crepe bandage width, which is 9 cm in width and 9 meter long. While applying the pressure, we have to be careful about the formation of the adductor roll after the amputation. There's a risk of developing adductor tightness and adductor roll. So by applying the bandaging, we are trying to reduce the formation of the adductor roll here.
Thank you.
Okay, then we have to take care of tactile sensations of the patients after the amputation. So tactile sensory stimulation and mirror therapy for reducing phantom sensation is major role in physiotherapist role after a bone knee amputation. As well as we have to take care of the correct positioning of the patient, as Ms. Nuvani explained. Here I have depict some photos where the position can be used for reducing especially the formation of adductor tightness and hip flexor tightness. And stump and sound limb strengthening exercises we are continuing. Here we are showing one of method we are using to strengthen the stump. Then again here we are depicting another photo where the gluteal area, abdomen and the pelvis area of the patient is getting strengthened. Here patient's sound limb is strengthening. Strengthening the sound limb also very important, especially for the gait training. Here for the reduction of the tightness of hip flexors and abductors we are doing these exercises. This first exercise is done to reduce the tightness of hip abductors, and here we are demonstrating the reduction of tightness in hip flexors. Here the patient is engaging in upper limb strengthening activities. Strengthening the upper limb is very important at the end of the rehabilitation program for the gait training. So here we are demonstrating how she is improving her single leg standing balance, which will be also very beneficial for her final gait training. So our long term goal for this patient is to make the patient independent in functional ambulation with a suitable aid and a prosthesis. If you have any questions, you can contact us later. Very much, and again thank you very much for our consultant sir, Dr. Dominda Munidasa, for giving this valuable opportunity for us.
Thank you Nuvani, and thank you Damit. Thank you very much for this two presentations that explain everything with regard to rehabilitation of amputees, and also for highlighting the value of this multidisciplinary contribution for rehabilitation of these amputee patients. So now once the patient is made independent, mobile, following rehabilitation with physiotherapy and so on, it's important that we integrate this patient back home. So now we have Mrs. Navoda Vikramasinghe, the occupational therapist of RRH, who would talk to us on home integration of amputees. So let me cordially invite Mrs. Navoda Vikramasinghe to make her presentation. Navoda, thank you.
Good afternoon. I am Navoda Vikramasinghe, occupational therapist working in Rehabilitation Hospital, Ragama. And I am here to talk about occupational therapy role in amputee management. The role of an occupational therapist is to work with clients to maximize their level of independence in day-to-day activities. Our rehabilitation process depends on factors as the location and type of amputation. Most commonly, we are working with people who have lower extremity above or below knee amputation. Next, the medical history and current health and age. It is important the overall health of a client to check the ability to reach the goals. Condition of remaining limb. It is important the muscle strength, endurance and control of remaining limb because it may have high energy consumption when performing an activity. Their home, work, environment, physical environment is important to ease of function for safe accessibility. Family and work roles and responsibilities. Active involvement of client and family members is vital to help the client to return back to highest level of function. Next, our rehabilitation process consists of two phases, pre-prosthetic and post-prosthetic. The aims of occupational therapy management to enable the individual to achieve his or her maximum level of independence in both pre-prosthetic and post-prosthetic. Occupational therapists will assess and identify areas of difficulties within ADL work and leisure. Common example of difficulties that we may work with are dressing and undressing upper and lower half, and meal preparation and transferring. Occupational therapists teach new techniques, suggest modifications, and provide adaptations to ease activities for energy conservation. Occupational therapists prescribe appropriate wheelchair with stump board for below knee amputation to prevent contractures and edema. Here shows a bilateral amputee client on wheelchair with anti-tip-up accessory which prevent backward falling when propelling a ramp. Occupational therapists need to identify falls, risk factors, and provide appropriate individual interventions. Occupational therapists need to assess and review the participation in recreational activities and resettle them in previous job or alternation job to create a sense of self-efficacy and re-establish life roles, because return to work after limb loss can be a very difficult transition. And occupational therapists also receive the support of social service department for necessary home modifications for people who have financial issues. And also we enhance functions of older adults who have had an amputation due to peripheral vascular disease or diabetes mellitus through environmental modifications appropriate for wheelchair use. Here in the first picture, you see the patient need a ramp for climbing stairs, and in the second one, the lady need a reacher to take objects on cupboard. Our assessment areas are home and environment, mobility, transferring, personal and domestic activities of daily living, pre-morbid functional level and cognitive functions, support systems as carers, families, and psychological factors, financial barriers, and at last the work assessment. Our treatment approach is holistic. A 59 years old female with left above knee amputation admitted for rehabilitation from Goal. She previously worked as a teacher in dressmaking attached to vocational training institution but stopped due to her weakness. She lives in multi-level three-storied house with good family support. Her spouse still works as a seaman and her daughter works in a bank. She complains of phantom pain and difficulty in performing ADLs and IADLs independently. She also has good functional sitting balance, has standing transferring, and some standing tolerance also. She has well-healed wound along anterior aspect of distal stump. Currently, she is in pre-prosthetic phase of rehabilitation. Our goals for her: train, educate, and assist to carry on her ADLs and IADLs with clutch walking, and minimize or prevent phantom pain, edema, and contractures using OT techniques such as pressure garments, massaging, and positioning. Discussing with family members, we make a discharge plan until she receives her prosthesis, and next resettle her with suitable home modifications, and ambulate successfully with use of prosthesis to get her to reach high level of functional independency, and supporting her in community access and return to work. These are the barriers in her home, and her home accessibility She has vehicle accessibility to home from road to land, and has 10 steps from courtyard to main door, but she can manage them with steps. Manage steps with the grab rail, and also she can manage unlocking and locking the main door. And this is the picture of her living area. It is situated in downstairs with tile floor and has manageable chair height. We advised about risk of falling from slippery floors and untidy carpets and wire cords. This is the bedroom of her. It is situated on ground floor with no steps. Light switches on reachable height. Telephone is there close to bed. And we advised about loose rugs, furniture, arrangement, and not to obstruct the doorways and walk away free from cords. This is the picture of the kitchen and dining area. There is a manageable 6-step from living room area to kitchen. And also she can manage them with the grab bar. Dining and kitchen area are in the same level. In the kitchen, the fire area, worktop and sink are in manageable height. No need to bend over to reach to the fridge or oven. She has continuous working surfaces, so she can slide the kettle or a saucepan without lifting it up. And we advise to store regularly using items in kitchen in low-level cupboards, and use slip-resistant mat, and use food trolley to carry prepared meals easily and safely from kitchen to dining area. This is the demonstration of using a gas stove and making a tea for the client. Her bathroom. She has attached bathroom, and the commode, wash basin and shower taps are in manageable height. Grab rails is there to get into and out of the shower. We advised to use a chair while on shower, and use a non-slip mat on the bottom of bath or shower, and hold onto the sink when using a commode, and walk into the toilet always with her walking aid. This is the stairs in her house. Just grab a bar and so which she can manage them. We advise to switch the lights on when using the stairs and paste a sticker at the edges of the steps to see clearly, and don't keep anything stored in the stairway. The laundry area also in the same level near the bathroom. She uses a washing machine. We advise us to use non-slippery mat and keep away wire cords. These are the home modifications and advices we given for her, and the last treatment goals will be achieved after she receives her prosthesis, and returning back to work is done with occupational therapy work assessment. And this is the end of my presentation, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Naoda. Thank you for this excellent presentation on integration of amputee to home setting. Our next presentation would be on providing the prosthesis. This is done by, or at least the patient is assessed, and the prosthesis needed for the patient will be evaluated by the prosthetist and orthotist. We would be having Mrs. Shamila Sundaralingam, the prosthetist and orthotist of RRH, to make this presentation. So let me kindly invite Mrs. Shamila Sundaralingam to make her presentation.
Good afternoon. I'm Sharmila. Before we move deep into the cases, I would like to introduce you about the prosthesis. Prosthesis is an artificial replacement for any or all part of the lower limb or upper extremities. So the main purpose of the prosthesis is to provide the function as much as possible and also giving the patient the good appearance as much as possible. For the lower limb, there is 5 type of prosthesis are there. So for this presentation, we will talk about definitive prosthesis. That's the prosthesis that patient use for to do normal day-to-day activities. There's a 3 stage of prosthetic management: pre-prosthetic, prosthetic, and post-prosthetic management. So pre-prosthetic management, my colleague has already mentioned. So to this presentation, I will focus mainly on prosthetic and post-prosthetic management. This is the normal procedure that we go through in order to provide prosthetic for the patient, so the assessment. So it's necessary for us to know what is the history of the patient in order to provide proper prosthesis to the patient. For example, patient age, the activity level, and the occupation that patients did before the amputation, and residual limb assessment to make sure are there any problem with the stump condition, health, and the skin tissues, and whether is it suitable for prosthetic fitting or not. And the other one is the transfemoral prosthesis assessment. So that part specifically focus on to provide prosthesis. And there's a 2 type of goals: short-term goals and long-term goals. We need to fix at the beginning of the rehabilitation. So for sometimes the patient, not all the patient at the beginning will be able to walk with free hand. So they start with the axillary crutches. So long time they will even able to walk with free hand. So it's necessary for us to decide to the short term goals and long term goals. So once we finish the normal assessment, it's always necessary for us to do the specific functional assessment, which will make sure us whether the patient will able to use the prosthesis or not, and what type of prosthesis that patient will benefit, and what type of the components that we can use. So this is the standard questionnaire we use our day-to-day activities to make sure the patient readiness, the fitness for the prosthetic use. For example, there's a few questions. The one is, so when we assess patient standing, how long the patient is able to stand with the prosthesis, able to stand with the sound sight. So is it for a 5 second, 30 second, how long? So once we ask the patient to stand or sit comfortably, how well they are doing the task. So those are the some assessment that we can make sure the patient readiness for the prosthesis. So once we complete the assessment part, if the patient is ready for the prosthetic management, we can do the casting procedure. Most of the time, transfemoral stump end up with flexion and abduction position. So it is necessary for us to make sure, are there any contracture or what is the normal position of the stump. So, and also, not only the stump, there is some other part, the overall standing position of the patients also, we need to make sure for later stage fitting and prosthetic weight training stage. So we started with the posture adjustment of the patients during casting. So one, we take enough measurements and the stump position is correct, then we need to do several adjustments. As the picture shows, illustrate, not only the affected limb, the sound limb measurements also we need to take to make sure the size of the foot and the prosthesis purpose. This is the normal assessment form that we use. In my right side hand, it's illustrating the residual limb and the sound sight, muscle strength and range of motion actively and passively. Oh, my left hand side, it is illustrating the measurements that we take during casting. So we need this measurement in order to shape the model. So this is the normal casting procedure we do for the transfemoral patients. So the cases that my colleagues are talking about, so she is undergoing a pre-prosthetic management. So this is how, once she finishes the pre-prosthetic management, these are the stages she needs to go through to get the prosthetic. So these pictures, the five pictures number 5 and 6 is explaining the hand position. So normally for transfemoral prosthesis, to get the copy of the stump, we need 2 people at least. Because even though our thigh section is a round shape, we don't make the socket in a round shape. So it should be some certain shape to avoid the rotation of the prosthesis on the stump while walking. So the number 7 is illustrating the alignment, the flexion and the adduction angle and the pelvic position of the patient. So this slide, my right side hand, pictures, 2 pictures are illustrating once the POP cast is set, and these 2 is the like sample of the cast, and the below picture is illustrating once the cast is set, it's ready for the modification. So there's a plaster of Paris powder is there. So once we dissolve that one into the water, so then we pour it into the cast. So it will set, then it will ready for the modeling. So this is the part, we call it a rectification. So once the cast is ready for the rectification, so once we remove the plaster of Paris bandages, then the cast is ready. The model is there. So we say it is a positive model. So even though we get a cast from patient, we don't just fit the same to the patient. There's a specific modification needed to be done. Because most of the time, during patients walking, there's the small remaining part of the femur started to move. So then they always complain the pain in the lateral side of the thigh. So focusing on those problems, we needed to adjust the socket during this stage. So the below picture is explaining the positive final cast model. So this is the fabrication procedure. So we have 2 types of materials. One is plaster polypropylene sheet, and the other polypropylene sheet. So it's a hard material, it's a sheet. So according to the patient's circumference, it's cut and it's placed into the oven. So with a certain type of temperature, 118 degrees, so for around 30 minutes, or one the polypropylene sheet, it will become like a liquid. So once it's ready, then it's wrapped around the positive model. So then we let it to cool it for overnight. So then we have a specific instruments to cut it, the socket, and remove from the cast. So then we have a specific instrument to make it the model, the plastic socket to be smooth or not to hurt the patients. So now we have the socket ready. Once we have the socket ready, and we need to adjust the socket with the knee joint as well as ankle joint. So we are doing only the socket. So the other parts are we get imported. So once the prosthetic is ready, before the patient walk, there is a 2 stage we need to go through. So static and dynamic. Statics always in a standing position. So before the patient started to walk, so during static, we need to make sure the fitting of the prosthesis. Is it too tight, too loose, or is it comfortable? And the height of the prosthesis. So for new amputees, before they started to walk, so there is always pre-prosthetic training take place. So pre-prosthetic training, it's help the amputated to adapt to their new condition and to make sure they are placing proper weight on the prosthesis side and their balance is good and they have the optimum gait pattern and they are using much less energy in order to work with the prosthesis. So mainly there's a four type of prosthetic training there. One is weight bearing and balance exercise. The other one specific gait training exercise. And other one is a advanced exercise. Once the patient is familiar with the prosthesis to make sure that they are able to walk with uneven terrain. So for that type, for that to help them, there's advanced exercises and functional exercises. So once the patient is ready, they can walk. So we need to make sure, are there any gait deviation? What is gait deviation? Gait deviation is something which is not normal. When we look at what is abnormal, when we compare with the sound side. So it is here I will talk about three things. When the patient is walking, so the patient prosthetic limb in the ground. So it's a just beginning, patient is weight bearing and the limb is not in the ground. So these are the three stages. During heel strike, I mean the heel is contact, prosthetic heel is contact. So we can see it instability of prosthetic knee. That means the patient's knee suddenly come to flexion position. So the patient is not stable. It can be due to patient is not comfortable with the prosthesis. I mean they are not yet ready to walk. Foot slap. Suddenly the foot move to with the big sound. It's moved to the old foot come to the back to the ground. So it may be sometimes it can be due to the improper alignment of the foot. And other one is that the foot while patient started to walk, the foot rotate to the other side. It can be due to the foot is new, so it may be the foot heel is a hurt. So once the patient is standing and the patient is putting the weight to the prosthesis, the one we call prop fob. That means patient body move above the foot and patient is almost going to fall. So it can be due to our prosthesis malalignment and patient need more training and lateral rung bending. It can be due to abductor's weakness as well as the prosthetic socket built in a wrong abduction position. So once the patient is complete the stand space and the patient prosthesis limbs in the ground. So sometimes we can see excessive lumbar lordosis. If some cases patients may have hip flexion contracture if we set the prosthesis socket in a malalignment. So if we are not providing enough accommodation for the high flexion, then the patient will start to walk with the lumbar lordosis and uneven keel rise is due to the socket we set it in a wrong flexion or extension position. Vaulting, we set the patient's prosthesis height is wrong. And medial and lateral whips, the prosthesis started to rotate in both either medial or lateral. So it can be due to the prosthesis socket fitting is wrong. And terminal impact. So it's a TF prosthesis. So once if we set the knee joint not in a tight, so once the patient started to contact the ground, the knee come to sudden stop. So we can even see the sound. And circumduction, in order to clear the ground, patient is clear the ground by avoiding circularly the patient try to do the circular motion and contact the ground. So it may be due to abduction contracture or it may be due to the prosthesis is too long. So once we adjust the gait deviation and the prosthesis is ready. So we always wanted to make sure how efficient the prosthesis is. For that one, there is some standard outcome measures we can use. So one simple one is a socket comfort score. So we can it's similar to the pain scale. So we can show to the patient and ask, so how do you feel about the comfortable with the prosthesis? So sometimes they can say 6 or Then if we do some adjustment, then they can say it's a 5. Then we know we need to revise the things. So the similar for the 6-minute walk test, we ask patients to walk for a 6 minutes of walk distance, and we measure their speed. So we think that if the patient is able to walk much fast, that means the prosthesis is good. The similar to PCI. So here we measure the heart rate. So how much the energy that patient is expending to walk with the prosthesis. So far we see the prosthetic management and post-prosthetic management. Post-prosthetics mean once we deliver the prosthesis to the patient, there is always necessary to do regular follow-up and maintenance, because the prosthesis is an artificial limb. It's a lot of mechanical parts there. So we need to make sure it's always in a good condition and it will not cause any problem to patients. And other things, the regular follow-up is necessary to make sure the patient's condition is always, the prosthesis is always well suited to the patient, or if any adjustment we need to do, we have to do it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shamila Sundaralingam, for that very comprehensive presentation. I think all in all that we had a fairly successful workshop, all with very much live demonstrations with the comprehensive coverage. The viewers are a little concerned to see. If I could take up a few questions, I think that I'm sure that Dr. Duvinda Mundas must be in the background. And the people are interested to know whether Sri Lanka or you being the Center of Excellency in Sri Lanka for amputee rehabilitation, whether you provide all these things free of charge, and whether there are varieties of the prosthesis that is available for patients and so on. Duminda?
Yeah, thank you, Padma, for this opportunity for our team to present. Yes, RRH is probably the practically the only the government institution which provides amputee rehabilitation free of charge. It's totally free of charge to all our patients who are coming in. But of course, time to time we run short of components. Like at the moment, we are having a bit of a backlog, but the Minister of Health is trying their level best to deliver us the components, because sometimes we run short of components, then we get a backlog of patients. But we were providing free of charge, and probably if the components come around, maybe even the NHSL, I think, now has possible facilities to do that. There are a few the private sector places where they do this, but of course, what is lacking mainly is the pre-prosthetic and post-prosthetic care is not there. They just make it and give it. So sometimes we get patients who have a prosthesis, but they have not been trained how to use it. So then we have to do that for ourselves when they come to us. I think probably Udit, we have some other NGO-run places in Maho and probably Vaunia also, where they provide some free of charge prosthesis for some people. Some places, of course, have their training themselves. So important part is actually to have a proper pre-prosthetic care and to have a post-prosthetic care as well. So hopefully that will answer that question.
Yeah, see, Duminda, now if they go totally in the private sector, about how much would this cost for patient?
I think that it will vary because these components, there's a grading of different grades of components depending on what which manufacturer, which country and things. So I'm not very sure. It sometimes can go up to about 3 to 4 lakhs can go up for a above knee, and maybe a little less down. Our costing is about 100,000 for the above knee without the labor or anything else, but the components. Yes. But private sector can go up to about 400,000. Yeah. There are cheaper ones, but then the components will be cheap and the duration of the durability of using them may be lower.
Thank you, Dhamendra. Now, in addition, now say if we consider that many of them as diabetics, is there any other than what your team mentioned, any other precautions that need to be taken to avoid the complications of the stump, mainly because of diabetes?
Yeah, again, I mean, the stump will have the same problems on top of the stump, actually the sound limb also. That is what we are more concerned, because that can get damaged, and if you have problems, then of course providing the prosthesis is going to be useless.
Yes.
So generally, we look at the overall diabetic care with the help of the endocrine colleagues, as well as the diabetic clinics are there and the foot care clinics are there. So it's sort of a teamwork looking at them. So there won't be a special thing about the stump, but we always take the same precaution for each one. But if you have sort of sensory loss, we'll be in trouble. So those are the issues with the diabetes. But when it comes to upper part, generally they don't have the problem. So other, or if the vascular part is okay for the stump, then we are safe. But actually what more concern will be the other limb rather than the stump.
Right, thanks. So are there any other types of transfemoral prosthetic sockets available at RRH other than...
Can I ask Shamila to answer that? My PM.
Yes. Shamila?
There is a... I'm not sure about the question, because like once we make for the patients, like one day, that's why that I talk about if I need the prosthesis. So it's a customized one. So it's not a prefabricated. So customized one, we cast for each patient. And there is a several socket designs also there. So depend on their anatomical and functional level and their condition. So there is a, like, for example, the one that I explained is a quadrilateral socket. So there are several socket designs also there, like we said ICS and those things. So if there is some patients, we have some limitation in the technology, but when we receive some patients, if there is a, like, we can do it, we do some special socket design also. So rather than that, so there is during pre-prosthetic stage, there is several socket, several prosthesis used and several socket designs also used.
Thank you, Shamila. Again, if the team could let me know that, do we, from Ragama, do we, other than the amputee, the leg, do we provide prosthesis for upper limb as well?
Yeah, we do. I mean, there's a two type of upper limb prosthesis are there. Like, one is a cosmesis upper limb prosthesis, and other one is a functional. Actually, in the functional one, there's several types are there. But what we do is like a basic. I mean, patient can use that one and do, like, we can't afford like a bionic arm and those things. But what we do is provide the prosthesis. So like a simple one, but we provide necessary training for the patients. So even though that they use whatever the components or whatever the device, the important thing is the socket. I mean, the one that we do the patient stuff. So we provide both cosmesis and the functional one. We provide both prosthesis.
Right. I think that brings very much to an end of our discussion on amputee rehabilitation. As the president of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, I'm very thankful to Dr. Dhamendra Munidas, the consultant rheumatologist, and his whole team, and for Dhamendra for mobilizing his whole team. And I know that you all did a wonderful job on rehabilitation of amputees for all our trainees who have joined, and all the members of the multidisciplinary team that who have joined on this workshop. So I think I'm very thankful to all of you for this massive contribution that was made for the benefit of amputees and the trainees who are there to learn on amputee rehabilitation. It is generally customary for the Sri Lanka Medical Association to official humbly acknowledge your services to Sri Lanka Medical Association. So I think that I should be able to send that in due course. Thank you very much again to all of you. And also let me thank all others who have joined online and stayed, remain with us until the end of this program. Thank you for all of you. Let me conclude the program. Thank you.